Very good morning and welcome everyone gathered here to the video lecture presentation on software development using UML and OOAD. The outline of my video lecture is focused like this: survey of software development methodologies, unified modeling language, unification from Rambach, Booch and Jacobson methodologies, what is modeling and why is modeling, and UML diagrams. So if you look at the survey of software development methodologies, if you look back from 1960s, there were many methodologies wandering in the world, starting from procedural methodology, functional methodology, object-oriented methodology, event-driven programming methodology, and so on. So no methodology suits for all types of problems. Therefore, a new methodology called unified modeling language has been invented from people like Jim Rambach, Gary Booch, Ivar Jacobson. These are three people who have contributed a major contribution to the field of computer science. So this unified modeling language, we take this word unified. This unification from three methodologies. What is that? Rambach methodology, Gary Booch methodology, Ivar Jacobson's methodology. So each one they have proposed different procedures or methods in style of programming. Actually, a programming paradigm is called a style of programming. So Rambach proposed a method called OMT, which is called Object Modeling technique, which contains three models. One is the object model, functional model, and a dynamic model. See, this OMT is object modeling technique, where this object model describes the structure of an object. The functional model describes what the object has to perform, the function or the main business what has to be concentrated, and the dynamic model will describe all the state transitions happens during performing a task between objects. Next is the Gary Booch methodology. He proposed several diagrams like class diagram, object diagram, state transition diagram, process diagram, module diagram, and interaction diagram. All diagrams like class, object, module, etc., with two processes, that is macro process and micro process. So each diagram has got its own role. The macro process is a controlling process for all the micro processes, and all the micro processes will be controlled by a macro process, or it has got its own macro process. So these diagrams we'll be discussing in the end of the lecture, where we'll be discussing this topic, UML diagrams, and macro process and micro process are involved in Gary Booch methodology. And the third methodology is Ivar Jacobson methodology, where he contributed to the software development like use case diagrams. And he proposed a new concept called Object-Oriented Software Engineering, which is called OOSE. In short, we can call this also as Object Tree. And also he has proposed one technique called OOBE, that is object-oriented programming at the enterprise level. So these three methodologies has been unified and put into unified modeling language. So it is combination of all these three methodologies. So this unification has led to great achievement in solving object-oriented problems. So why modeling? We have chosen modeling because it is something similar to constructing a building. So before we construct a building, we generate a blueprint. Similarly, before starting to construct a software, we need to get the blueprint of the software. Because if it is a small building, we are not going to concentrate much on blueprints. But if it is complicated building, the complexity increases, we go for blueprints. Because the communication, when the communication between increases, we need modelings, constructions. Therefore, we go for modeling. So here, unified theories and the modeling, constructing model, put into a language called unified modeling language. So unified modeling language is not a language like C++ or C or Java, but it is wrapped under many tools like rational rows, etc. So now we go for, we'll take one example and explain how a single statement is converted as a software. Let me take one example. Normally we are aware in software development, we have a software development process starting from gathering requirements, collecting of requirements, making analysis, design, implementation, testing and maintenance. Now I take one requirement. For example, a patient seeks an appointment with a doctor. Appointment with the doctor. So how are we going to convert this task or function, a small function, into this methodology, VML methodology? So for this, for analysis, we have to take the use case diagram proposed by Jim Bramberg. So what is done here? A patient here is considered as an actor. Actor is represented by a symbol like this, a stick figure. A stick figure. What does he do? He makes an appointment. He makes an appointment. He makes an appointment. It means he has to make an appointment with somebody in the hospital. So you have somebody is there like scheduler. Scheduler in a hospital. Scheduler in a hospital. So he is an actor, or you can say patient, doing some task, that is some use case. It is represented by a symbol like this, a oval symbol. Makes an appointment with the scheduler in a clinic. So this is the relationship. This is the relationship. That is, this line shows communication. Communication with the scheduler in a clinic. So what are the other possible tasks it can be done with this request? So when the actor makes an appointment, seeks an appointment, the scheduler has the responsibility or has a role to play. Whether she or he will give an appointment, or he will postpone appointment, or sometimes you can cancel appointment. So this is a scenario, your patient seeking appointment. Now you can add many scenarios to this use case. Either you can make an appointment or you can cancel appointment. cancel appointment can be done. If not, if you are meeting the doctor, then you can request for medication. You can request medication. It is another task. When you request medication, it is your doctor. So another person comes here as a doctor. So when you request medication, the doctor is giving medication. So then you have to pay the bill. So another task is coming, pay bill. So when you want to pay bill, another actor comes in, like some clerk, some accounts clerk. Some accounts clerk. So imagine a scenario, actually use case is a scenario. The single scenario, the analysis made like this. You can make an appointment, you can cancel appointment with the scheduler, you can request medication with the doctor, you can pay bill to the clerk. So this is the analysis we have made. But it is a single scenario, we can make good analysis. But if the scenario becomes complicated, always in software development, collecting requirements is very difficult. And if at all it is collected, making analysis much more difficult. Why I say? Because when you want to collect requirements, you can, there are four ways. You can examine the existing document, examine the existing document. You can conduct interviews. You can set questionnaires and pass it to the group for collection of materials. And fourth type is you can make observation. So we collect materials from many methods, like examining the existing document, conducting interviews, questionnaire, observation. So after this requirements collection or gathering, we arrive at many problems. Problems like, because the collected requirements may be fuzzy description. Number two, incomplete requirements. These unneeded or unnecessary features. Only because of these three reasons, fuzzy descriptions, incomplete requirements, or unnecessary features, analysis becomes a difficult activity. Fuzzy description means, suppose a customer says, I want this project to be done and this task has to be completed. It should have a faster response time. So faster response time means what? Which is fast? 5 seconds is fast, 6 seconds, 1 second, microseconds. The time that depicts fast response time is open to interpret. I may interpret microseconds, somebody may interpret 1 second or 2 second or 5 seconds. So that part, it becomes fuzzy. It is not clear, ambiguous. So we have to make a decision there. So then incomplete requirements, sometimes the person who is collecting the requirement may give incomplete data due to high cost, or he will, by oversight, he will give incomplete requirements which will create problems for the analysis. Then unnecessary features. So in any software development process, only the necessary features has to be incorporated. Otherwise, any small unnecessary feature inside the requirements will make the software performance poor. It will increase cost. It will increase construction time. So many practical difficulties are there. So the first diagram, use case diagram, this is called as use case diagram. helps for making analysis, helps for making analysis, where these are called as use cases. So these lines are linked lines, represent associations or relationships in the diagram. So this one concept of making analysis is incorporated into unified process by this person, Jacobson. And next we go to what are the diagrams present in this UML language and who proposed how they are useful for good development of a software. So we have use case diagram. Class diagram, object diagram, state transition, sequence diagram, collaboration diagram, activity diagram, component diagram, deployment diagram. All these diagrams comprise UML diagrams. So we have seen use case diagram, and the next one is the class diagram. So for class diagram, I'll take another example. Like the previous example, I seek one line statement. A customer makes an order. Or he tries to purchase an item. Purchase an item. So we can construct use cases, many use cases for this task to be performed. As we know about use case diagram, now we directly move to class diagram. What class diagram should be useful for making a purchase? So we must analyze. Actually, this UML language has peculiar properties or powerful properties. We say you have to specify visualize construct and document. So for any object oriented software problem solving, we need some imagination. So we take the specification one. This customer makes an order. Now I visualize as in the UML language, for this to happen, a customer is necessary. He has to make an order. There should be order details. Then there should be an item. So when we all perform this, at least we need to make a payment. So in my conception, I need all these components to construct a model for this scenario. So I put customer as one class. This payment can be put down. The customer has got customer name, address. I see this. This is the class diagram. Like we had use case diagram, some oval symbols. Here, you have a rectangle divided into three compartments. First one is the class name. This depicts class name. This depicts attributes. This depicts some operations, what we perform. Some operations like here making an order or purchase something, what we perform on that can make. So any class diagram is represented by a rectangle divided into three compartments. The first one has got class name, customer, class attributes. We have customer name and address. We can add any attributes that are relevant here, and the operations like purchase. So this customer makes an order. It is another class. Customer makes an order. Similarly, this order object or class will have some attributes like order date, status, calculate total function. So the order details. Similarly, we'll have attributes. Order item. We can add any attributes. Calculate subtotal. Calculate subtotal. Then this item which contains item details. So shipping weight, descriptions, some operations. Similarly, when you want to payment, we have different methods of payment. So payment is a class. The customer can make a payment through many methods. Now we have credit, can pay by cash, can give by check. Here can give bank ID, can give cash tendered, can have credit number, date. So these are all these classes are related. All these classes are related. There exists association between all the classes. These are combined classes, these aggregated. We have aggregation has to be represented by a triangle. So hollow diamond. So any class diagram will comprise all its classes. Now all the classes are associated. There exists relationship between each and every class. So what type of relationship? What type of relationship? Because a customer can order any number of items. Any number of items. So we represent like this. A customer orders items is exactly one. One denotes exactly one. And the zero dot star is depicting number of any number of orders, any number of items. So this is an association. This is an association. Here order contains order details and items. Order details and items. So this class is aggregation of these two classes. These two classes. Therefore, there is an association relationship called aggregation. Yes, multiple relationship. Yes, multiple relationships to all these three diagrams. So we have a concept called multiplicity. Called multiplicity. So when you want to make a payment, you can make payment in three ways: by credit, cash, and check. Therefore, payment becomes superclass of all these three classes. Payment becomes superclass, which will be represented with a hollow triangle. The inheritance link tending towards the superclass is called relationship, is called generalization. Is called generalization. Then another relationship is called navigability. Navigability is a technique where how we traverse in this task, how we traverse in the task, that is to be considered. The traversing of the process, customer making an order, order details are stored, payment is done, item is released. It is the navigability. So this is the class diagram has reached this stage after making analysis and design. Actually, this is the design part where we are going to solve the problem. If anything goes wrong here, the result will be poor. So it will be poor. So we have some definite rules and regulations for making a class diagram. So because in any software development, design is the solution. If the design goes wrong, solution will go wrong or not to the expected level. So for which we have to follow two axioms in making class diagrams. We have to follow several rules like axiom 1. Is called independence axiom. Axiom 2, information axiom. So this what is this independence axiom says? Every module in the project or every component should be independent. It should not be much dependent on other modules or components. The dependency should be low. Various we might have seen coupling and cohesion. And this information axiom shows that any known fact should be explained with maximum simplicity, minimum complexity, and straightforwardness. So this says any known facts should be explained minimum complexity, maximum simplicity, and straightforwardness. So we say axiom is a fundamental truth which is observed to be valid. Any axiom is a fundamental truth which is observed to be valid, contains independence axiom and information axiom, where this information axiom says that anything you represent should be of minimum complexity, maximum simplicity and straightforwardness. So based on this, we have arrived at six corollaries. Corollary 1, uncoupled design with less information content. Corollary 2, single purpose. Corollary 3, strong mapping. Corollary 4, large number of simple classes. Corollary 5, standardization. Number 6, design with inheritance. So these rules has to be applied there. Uncoupled design with less information content. So the dependency factor should be less. So the cohesion should be high inside, coupling should be low between and among the projects. So single purpose is, you can observe from here, every class has got a single purpose. The purpose or the task should not be mingled together. You should have a single purpose. Any class should have a single purpose. For example, customer has to make an order. Order class has to store the order details. Order detail will have the particular specified order. This will have specified item. So that is why these two details will be there in order. That is why we say here aggregation, or we have multiple relationship to the class order. Similarly, this should be very clear and simple, because payment can be three types. That should be made very clear. That is single purpose. Strong mapping. Strong mapping is, there should be a interaction between the logical working and the physical purpose. Then large number of simple classes. This we have followed in this class diagram. It's a single task and we have around 7 to 8 classes. Instead of putting all the details in one class, I have separated large number of classes with the large number of simple classes with the single task. So now the classes should be standardized. And you have to design with inheritance. Design with inheritance here is, if this class is designed, it can be reused somewhere. If somebody is needing in another project, some customers will have same details, similar type of work, similar type of function, customers will have same work, so they can be reused. And if you observe here, these class diagrams can be reused. So that is design with inheritance. So in designing, we have followed these axioms, independence axiom, information axiom, all the facts and all the corollaries, and we have made a good design in customer making a purchase. So we have seen all the diagrams, use case and class diagram. Next type of diagram in this UML diagram is object diagram. So when we have number of classes, more number of classes, that classes can be grouped into a particular group, which is called as a package, Here we have a list of classes like accounting, bank, user interface, ordering, shipping, customer database and stock database. So this rectangle with a small tab at the left top is a symbol for package. So it shows that accounting, bank and stock databases are dependent on one another, all the dependency factors are given. So this package diagram is a group of classes representing a group of classes, and this is an object diagram. This is an object diagram. You can see here, object diagram represents a department. A department has got degree courses, got graduate, undergraduate, and both the courses. A department normally contains many sub departments. Many sub departments, that is clearly explained here. You can take department is a class. At the bottom, you can have this mathematical education department and applied max department. So these two comes under mathematical department, and we have parallelly we have statistics course. So this mathematical and statistical courses combined together, it forms a mathematical stat department. So here department is the class name, and these are objects: mathematics, statistics, applied mathematics, mathematical education, and max department are sub departments. So this relationship is depicted here. These departments are aggregated to form major departments. So any department can have any number of sub department. That depicts 0 dot dot star. So one depicts some relationship. So this is an object diagram representing a generalized aggregation relationship. The next diagram is sequence diagram. So sequence diagram is a diagram which explains the sequence of events that takes place in a particular task. Actually, we have taken an example, making a reservation of a room in a hotel. So we have a reservation window, which is called user interface window. A message called make reservation is sent to chain of hotels. Chain of hotels. From the chain of hotels, the make reservation request is sent to a particular hotel. So the particular hotel verifies whether the room is available. If it is available, it sends a message, sends a confirmation message. In this diagram, we can also make notes like this: some rectangle with a tilted triangle at the right top, which is called as a note relationship. So this line depicts a message. These two bars are called activation bars. The message is existing from this chain of hotels to hotel. That is called lifeline in an association. Then after everything is over, room is booked, this relationship depicts deletion of the message. So sequence diagram, even if a simple task we take, it requires a sequence. For example, we dial a phone. For that we need some sequence of events. We need to go to the phone, we have to take the dial, we have to ring the numbers, the number has to go, somebody has to attend on the other end, whether they have to reply. If they reply, the message has to reach us, then we have to speak, then we have to finish the message and keep the dial down. So any small activity will have sequence of events. So the sequence of events will be drawn using these diagrams. And the next diagram is the collaboration diagram. The sequence diagram and the collaboration diagram are much related. So in a rational Rose tool, if you give a sequence diagram and if you press a particular button F5, this collaboration diagram will be easily generated. Actually, this sequence diagram represents the role by time, but this collaboration diagram represents the same activity, sequence of activities, using numbers. You can have here 1.1, make reservation at the level. So next level is 1.1.1, make reservation to a chain of hotels. Then the process takes place at the same level, the sub level. You can numbers. So if you represent the sequence by numbers, it is collaboration diagram, and if it is by time, it is sequence diagram. So this is another diagram which represents state chart diagram. The status, the state of the particular task at any time. Any time, if you carefully look at this diagram, has got a dark circle which represents initial state. Somebody is asking for getting SSN number, so for getting PIN number, if you make a request, that PIN number or SSN number will be validated. If it is okay, it will accept, otherwise it is reject. So here symbols relationship to note are the transition, the state of the particular function or operation. So that is initial state, and you can see this symbol, it is a final state, that is a dark circle inside a hollow circle. So any dark circle is initial state, inside a hollow circle is final state, and here some relation action is taken, validating whether yes or no, that is taken decision, which is called as an action in state chart diagram. So for any task to be performed, all the status will be noted. So then activity diagram, this is, I have taken an example, how to withdraw money from an ATM bank, to withdraw money from ATM bank. This is an activity being done. So we have three major compartments. One is the customer is essential, ATM machine is essential, and the bank is also essential for withdrawing ATM transactions. So what is the activity, that sequence of activity that we do? We start the process, we used to go on insert card, customer does this work, insert card, you will get a screen message, enter your PIN number. So this entering PIN, we are going to enter the PIN number, that is an activity, that is an activity. So when we enter the PIN, this will reach the bank, this PIN number will be verified by the authorized agency in the bank. This authorization will check for whether the valid PIN or invalid PIN. You can express here, God expression is there, because there if it is a false PIN number, that is guarded, that is will not be allowed, that is made as invalid PIN. Once it is okay, we enter the amount, enter the amount. Once the amount is entered, the bank will check whether the amount entered on the account balance in our account is at least 1 rupee more than what we request, or in terms of constraints, in terms of thousands, all the constraints will be verified there. Verified, and if the balance is available, the amount is released. So when the amount is released, here is the technical activity that we have to do. When the amount is released, the amount must be sent to the slot. Then at the same time, the message has to be sent. At the same time, the amount we have withdrawn should be debited from the account. These are all happening in a concurrent time. So we have many operations working together, will be represented as a fork. It's a dark rectangle. And many operations join together, which is called as a joint operation, which will show the balance. So all these merge, and finally we eject card. ATM machine will eject the card, and we take the card out, and the activity is finished. So this type, this activity diagram has to be drawn for all the scenarios in the our project. So after these activity diagrams are noted, the selected implemented project should be deployed in the client side. So for deployment, we have this component diagram and this deployment diagram. This is for an application for real estate server. We have a PC, real estate server, and the bank server. We have mortgage applications, we have customers, listings, and all those things. So finally, in this type of software development, we have to deploy the software using deployment diagram. So this is deployed in a tool called Rational Rows. So when you have use case diagram, thus diagram, we have to generate class diagram. All the properties has to be added. All these properties can be executed. We have to realize in the software. Then we have to go to the tools bar in the Rational Rows, where it will, there is an option called develop update code or construct code. So once the code is constructed, we give a particular language. which language is necessary. So that language will generate code skeleton for the deployed class diagram. So this UML language, all these diagrams proposed by Grady Booch has been merged into this unified modeling language. So after all these diagrams have been drawn, we can develop code for any language. So UML is a language where we can generate code with the design developed, that is with the design of the class diagram and the component diagram. This tool will generate code in any language. So if you follow object oriented methodology, it will develop code only in a particular language. If you put in Java, Java, or it is C++, it is C somewhere. But when you develop a model, that model is enough to generate code in many languages, be it C++, be it Java, be it Visual Basic, or any other language. That is a powerful technology used in modeling technique. So this unified modeling language is a language which is based on specification, visualization, construction, and documentation. So I have seen specifying with the specifications, visualizing through constructing models. We have constructed code using several tools available under UML head. And finally, any development we have to document. Documentation is very much essential for in a software development. But documentation has got a definite rules. Any documentation should have a common cover. It should follow 80-20 rule. It should be used by a familiar vocabulary. It should be organized. So what is mean by this common cover? Any document, we might have seen many books, many famous popular books. The documentation of the book will be effective. The packaging or the document cover, common cover. There should be a common cover. And the document what you have written inside should follow 80-20 rule, which is called as, if what you have written is understood only by reading 20% of the document, that is, if you read the 20% of the document, you must be able to understand 80% of percentage of the content available in the document. So what I say is, it should be simple and it should be understandable. That is, we must use a familiar vocabulary in any documentation. We should not use it as an opportunity to show our English proficiency or our greater vocabulary. It should be very simple and it should be understood. So that is familiar vocabulary, and we have to make any document as short as possible, because if it is going long, we might not be able to understand it better. We may violate 80-20 rule. So it should be very clear, legible, and finally we must organize the procedures, organize the document. It should not be zigzag or random. Any document should be organized. Even if you note, first in software development, we must give about requirements, requirements collection, what is analysis, how we have analyzed, what is the design, how we have implemented, how we are testing, how are we going to maintain. So in this session, we have seen a new methodology, that is software development using UML and OAD, in which we have seen survey of software development methodologies. We have seen unified modeling language, which is called as an UML. We saw about unification of three methodologies, Jim Rambach, Grady Booch, and Ivar Jacobson, where Jim Rambach focuses on OMT technique, which has got functional model, analysis model, and dynamic model. Then Grady Booch with all the diagrams like class, object, state, module, process, and interaction diagrams. And third one, Ivar Jacobson, by use cases and object oriented software engineering, OOAC and OOBE. Then we discussed about all the UML diagrams, why modeling is needed, construction, and we have seen design axioms and corollaries. which is information axiom, independence axiom, and all the six corollaries. Then we saw documentation. What is documentation? How a documentation should be, and everything. And I hope this lecture, software development using OOAD and UML, be of much useful to the students and the audience. And at this juncture, I take this opportunity to thank the management for providing this opportunity. Thank you, Andam.